Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Dogs for Dummies, Second Edition, by Gina Spadafori, narrated by Eva Wilhelm. Limit of liability, disclaimer of warranty. The publisher and the author make no representations or warranties with respect to the accuracy or completeness of the contents of this work and specifically disclaim all warranties, including without limitation, warranties of fitness for a particular purpose. No warranty may be created or extended by sales or promotional materials. The advice and strategies contained herein may not be suitable for every situation. This work is sold with the understanding that the publisher is not engaged in rendering legal, accounting, or other professional services. If professional assistance is required, the services of a competent professional person should be sought. Neither the publisher nor the author shall be liable for damages arising herefrom. The fact that an organization or website is referred to in this work as a citation and/or a potential source of further information does not mean that the author or the publisher endorses the information the organization or website may provide or recommendations it may make. Further, readers should be aware that internet websites listed in this work may have changed or disappeared between when this work was written and when it is read. Foreword. These days, people's pets have become bona fide members of the family. Moving from the kennel to the couch, they share our beds, family rooms, and holidays, and are recipients of our kindest impulses and utmost concern. Yet pet owners know that a pet is also a big responsibility because they are dependent on us for almost all of their basic needs, including food, water, shelter, and love. A pet is a living being whose life your human family will shape, share, and nurture. A pet partnership is a lifetime commitment. Do it right, and your pet will become an important and valuable part of the family for years to come. Do it wrong, and you've broken a sacred covenant between mankind and man's best friend. As a veterinarian who's done thousands of new puppy and kitten visits, and as someone who works with the leading veterinary experts at most of the major veterinary schools in the United States, I've had the good fortune to see firsthand what steps you can take to begin your pet ownership the right way. Luckily, they are all found in the wonderfully written, comprehensive book that you hold in your hands, Dogs for Dummies, written by Gina Spadafori. Many veterinarians recommend this award-winning book to new pet owners because it so quickly and easily delivers the information that clients want and pets need. It's a proven in-the-trenches look at the simple steps you can and must take to make your pet an ideal pet, one that is well-behaved, content, and perfectly integrated within the human family. I enthusiastically recommend Dogs for Dummies to all of my clients and to millions of pet lovers through my work on television, radio, and in print because the book is both a comprehensive manual and a quick reference, is easily understandable yet authoritative, and is inspirational as well as instructional. Complete this educational book and you'll have an honorary doctorate degree in the bond. Buying this book is most certainly one of the greatest gifts you can give a beloved pet. By following the principles, plans, and proven positive approaches described in Dogs for Dummies, you'll be the owner every pet wants and deserves, informed, responsible, and loving. Marty Becker, DVM. Introduction. Welcome to the second edition of Dogs for Dummies, the canine reference for those who want all the basics covered in one easy-to-use book. Well, you've found it. Dog health, dog training, not to mention dog gear, dog grooming, dog breeding, and dog sports. Whether you're looking to adopt a dog, trying to improve your relationship with the one you have, or attempting to come up with fun things to do with your furry pal, this book contains something for you. The first edition of Dogs for Dummies was the first of the For Dummies pet books, and the most common question I heard was, "Wait, don't they just do computer books?" I don't hear that anymore, with For Dummies books available on just about any imaginable topic, and with lots more on the way. Dogs for Dummies was more than the first For Dummies pet book. It was my first book. I'd written a pet care newspaper column for many years, and I was featured in the pets area of American Online when I was asked to write the first edition of this book. I felt like my prayers had been answered when I was offered such a great opportunity. The first edition of Dogs for Dummies was critically acclaimed and named Best General Reference and Best Writing on Dogs by the Dog Writers Association of America. Even more important, I started hearing from lots of book buyers about how much my work had helped them. Buoyed by the success of Dogs for Dummies, I co-authored Cats for Dummies and Birds for Dummies. I'm proud of them all, but this book will always be my first, and I'm so happy to have the opportunity to make it even better. So make yourself comfortable and enjoy this comprehensive and easy-to-follow book for dog lovers, from dog lovers. The dog you get, or the dog you have, will thank you. Believe me. We love dogs. To death, sometimes. In spite of the popularity of dogs, some numbers suggest we don't love dogs all that much. How can anyone explain a society where doggy birthday parties and doggy daycare aren't all that rare, but millions of dogs are put to death every year in humane society shelters and municipal animal control facilities? Undoubtedly, some of these dogs are semi-wild strays, some are psycho, some incurably ill, and some are ancient. But many are none of those things. They're healthy, young, beautiful dogs, mixes and purebred both, who will die because the people who took them in don't want them anymore, for reasons as frivolous as redecorating and as serious as biting. And what about the puppies who won't make it? Where did they come from? Some end up in shelters as part of oops litters. Others are leftovers from litters planned by people who overestimated the demand for golden retrievers or poodles or Rottweilers and got tired of the extra mouths to feed. Because no one wants to imagine the worst, everyone who has ever dropped a dog at a shelter imagines that he ends up in a perfect home. For many, that home is in heaven. Such is the dark side of a dog-crazy society. How do dog disasters happen? Too many decisions about dogs are made because of emotions, not facts. The truth is, most of us are suckers for a puppy face. Few things are more adorable than a puppy, no matter the breeding. They are endowed with noses like licorice jelly beans, big eyes that sparkle with curiosity and affection, big paws and gangly legs that give them an adorably bouncy gait, and soft, fluffy fur that's better for snuggling than any teddy bear ever made. Like human babies, puppies even smell special. My own theory is that they are made this way as some kind of ingenious natural defense to keep the humans they rely on from seeking revenge for every carpet soiled, every finger nipped, and every couch corner chewed during what can seem at times a very long babyhood and adolescence. You come upon your wondrous puppy in possession of your new and very expensive running shoes, the upper of the left one neatly severed from its sole by sharp puppy teeth. You feel the blood rush to your face. The puppy stops, a piece of fine leather dangling from an eye tooth. Before you can snap his little neck, he's running toward you, stumbling over those big paws of his, every inch of his body happy to see you. And before you know it, you're smiling. See what I mean? Do you think a wild dog would fall for cuteness? Think again. He'd nail him if they had been his running shoes, or his tasty leg of rabbit. Cuteness counts for nothing in the wild. The awe factor. It's a shame we aren't a little less impressionable where puppies are concerned. Every year, hundreds of thousands of people bring puppies into their homes, many after little more than a moment or two of thought. If you take away only one thing from this book, it should be that getting a dog on impulse offers low odds for a successful relationship. Still, it's easy to see how it happens. Maybe you see a puppy at the mall, in a pet store window that's emblazoned with the symbols of every credit card in your wallet. Or maybe you get waylaid by a couple of kids outside the grocery store, hawking a box of free puppies. And you say the amount of shedding isn't really that bad? You ask the nice people at the pet store while cuddling a collie pup, thinking of your navy blue couch and your closet full of basic black. The puppy sighs and snuggles against your chest, Soon, you're adding a lint brush to the growing pile of supplies on the counter, and lest you start to worry about the cost, the sales clerk quickly points out that you can always breed your dog and get your money back with puppy sales. You look at that wonderful puppy face and imagine 7 more just like her, and then 7 times the purchase price in your pocket. A beautiful pet and a return on your investment? Sold! Or maybe you're moved by pure altruism. "Say, mister, that one really seems to like you," says the kid in front of the market as you stop just long enough to cuddle the pup with that amazingly adorable patch over his eye. The puppy is licking your fingers while your brain struggles to work this dilemma out. You know you ought to call your spouse. But hadn't you talked about getting a dog someday, now that you've bought a house? How much effort can a little puppy be? You always had dogs when you were a child. How can you deny your children that pleasure? "Dad says if we don't get rid of them today, he's going to drown them," says the kid urgently. "Not Patch!" you yell, and a little while later you're driving home with a puppy in your lap and 10 pounds of puppy food in the trunk of your car. Puppy love is fleeting. When it comes to puppies, love at first sight is a disaster in the making. A year later, Patch and the collie touch noses at the shelter. On TV, Timmy never seemed to care about Lassie's fur on his jeans, but you can't stand it on your clothes anymore. As for Patch, who'd have thought he'd turn out to be so large? You have neither the kind of space nor the time for the exercise he needs, and you're tired of yelling at the kids over whose turn it is to clean up the yard. One dog isn't house-trained, the other never seemed to understand that chewing wasn't okay. Not surprising, because neither dog was ever trained as a puppy. They're still nice dogs, though. Young and apparently healthy. A country home, a little training, and they'd be perfect. For someone else. Problem is, they aren't so cute anymore. Maybe they both make it. Maybe neither does. It's not your fault, is it? A preventative approach. Nobody adopts a dog guessing that they'll be dropping him off at the shelter later. Just thinking about doing so is heartbreaking. You get a dog because you want a loving, well-mannered companion, a playmate for the children, a crime deterrent, perhaps. The most important factors in determining whether you end up with your dream dog or an ill-mannered and possibly dangerous beast is how well you educate yourself before you buy, and how well you educate your dog thereafter. That's part of what this book is all about, preparing you to make the right selection when you're ready to adopt a dog and giving you the information you need to make good on the bright promise of that first meeting. Improving the dog you have. Of course, many people wouldn't dream of giving up on their dogs, although the infatuation stage is long past and the relationship is strained. They endure bad dogs the way they do bad marriages, and for many of the same reasons. Because the children would be heartbroken, or because friends and relatives would be disappointed. Because it's the right thing to do, or because they don't want to admit they made a mistake. Because if they wish hard enough, maybe the situation will get better. Because maybe the problem is their fault and they're sure that they still love him, or her. Is this you? You may get points for being a good sport, but admit it, this isn't any fun. You want a good dog. I can help you with that. Your marriage? You've got the wrong book. Although there is a For Dummies book on making marriage work and another on rekindling romance. Why you need this book. A saying in dog training circles, "Every handler gets the dog he deserves," refers to the fact that your chances at success are directly related to your abilities to choose, raise, and live with your dog properly. What you put in determines what you get out. In the more than 10 years that I've been advising people about dog problems, I've discovered that, more often than not, the lack of accurate information, not the lack of effort or concern, is the number one reason for doomed people-pet pairings. What kind of dog do you deserve? I think you deserve a healthy, happy, and well-mannered canine companion, and I'm going to show you how to get one, or turn yours into one. And then I show you how to have a great time sharing your life with your wonder dog. Becoming an informed consumer. Think about what you did before you bought your last car or television set. You probably comparison shopped, trying to figure out which manufacturer made the product that was best for you in terms of its specifications, its reputation for reliability, and its cost to purchase and maintain. If you're young, single, and in an entry-level job, I'm guessing you didn't buy a minivan. Likewise, if you spend a lot of time ferrying your daughter's soccer team to the pizza parlor on Saturday afternoons or buying plywood sheets for the latest home improvement project, your choice wasn't a sporty economy car. As for the TV, you probably took a tape measure with you to make sure that it fit in your entertainment cabinet. Now, consider the following. If things go right, you'll have a dog longer than you'll keep a new car and probably longer than a TV will work. So why should it come as a surprise that you need to shop carefully for a dog? Take your time, study the specifications, determine the rate of defects, consider the cost of maintenance, even do your homework on the person from whom you get a dog, because if you have a warranty, you want to deal with people who will be there when you need them. You need to be a savvy shopper before you get a dog and every day after. Keep in mind that you'll be buying food and supplies for the life of your dog. Don't worry, I'll give you tips. With that attitude and the information that follows in this book, you're well on your way to becoming a dog expert, and better still, a satisfied dog owner. How this book is organized. Dogs for Dummies is divided into 5 sections. If you're looking for a dog, you might want to start at the beginning. If you already have a dog, you can skip around, checking out the chapters that address your most urgent dog problems. If you want to impress your coworkers by explaining the difference between the 2 kinds of terriers, you probably want to read the whole book. No matter the order you choose, here's what you'll find. Part 1. Bringing a puppy or adult dog into your life. Mixed breed or purebred? What size? What breed type? Puppy or adult? Male or female? Breeder, humane society, or pet store? Complicated as these decisions may be, they're also some of the most enjoyable ones you'll ever make. This section walks you through them, step by step. Part 2. Getting the relationship off to the best start. Once you get your new puppy or dog home, there's everything you need to get the relationship off on the right paw, including house training tips for little pups or big dogs. You'll find the information you need on dog supplies in this section too, along with help on feeding your dog. Part 3. Keeping your dog healthy. Basic care for all stages and ages are outlined here, along with tips on choosing animal care professionals. Learn how to groom your dog, spot health problems early, and choose the right veterinarian. Common health problems are covered in this section, as well as information on how to make your dog's senior years comfortable and happy. Part 4. Living happily with your dog. Basic training and problem solving are covered in this part, along with what you need to know to get involved in dog sports. Traveling with your dog is the focus of another chapter. You'll also find an overview of breeding, along with reasons why your dog is almost certainly better off not becoming a parent. Part 5. The Part of Tens. From protecting your landscaping to the best websites for dog lovers, some of the best has been saved for last. Read these chapters with your dog in your lap. You'll both enjoy them more. Icons used in this book. Technical stuff. Maybe you want to know a little more why some house training strategies work better than others. This icon is the place to look to find that sort of information. If you just want to catch the basic concepts, give this guy a pass. Tip. This icon flags things that are especially useful for making living with your dog easier or making your dog happier and healthier. Remember, this icon reminds you of information so important that you should read it more than once, just to make sure it stays with you. Warning. This icon marks some of the most common mistakes dog owners make, along with tips for avoiding them. How to reach me. I invite you to tell me about your dog and your tales of living with a canine companion. You can read the exploits of my animals, as well as up-to-date information on animal health and behavior, as part of my weekly column, Pet Connection, which is provided to newspapers by the Universal Press Syndicate and also appears every week in the Pet Care Forum, vin.com/petcare, part of the Veterinary Information Network, vin.com, a subscription service for veterinary professionals. I also write an exclusive essay on pets every week for pets.com. You can email me at writetogina@spadafori.com, but snail mail is just as nice to get at the following address: Gina Spadafori, PMB 211, 5714 Folsom Boulevard, Sacramento, California, 95819. Beyond the book. In addition to what you're listening to right now, this book comes with a free Access Anywhere cheat sheet. To get this cheat sheet, go to dummies.com and search for Dogs for Dummies 2nd Edition Cheat Sheet by using the search box. 1. Bringing a puppy or adult dog into your life. In this part, explains where to look for your new puppy or dog, how to choose the right one for you, and how to get the relationship off to a good start. In here, you'll get the information you need to evaluate whether a male or female, puppy or grown dog is a better fit with your family. If you want a purebred puppy, you get the facts you need to find a good breeder and find out why you should avoid any other kind. Considering a grown dog? A mixed breed? Good for you! I give you plenty of information in this part to help you find a good source. Chapter 1. Considering the canine possibilities. In this chapter, choosing the right breed, factoring in energy, fur, and intelligence, deciding on age and gender. You don't have to spend much time looking at dogs to realize that our canine companions may have started out as wolves, but we've meddled some since then with amazing results. No matter how many steps or how many hundreds of years passed, imagining the ancestor of a Maltese or a toy poodle as a wolf is difficult at best. A Malamute, sure. A German Shepherd, and maybe even a Collie. You can see the wolf in them. But a Maltese? Fluffy, sweet-natured, and small enough to fit in an oversized purse. It's hard to imagine such an animal chasing deer through a frozen forest or lifting a muzzle to howl at the moon. But if you spend some time observing even the smallest, most adorable dogs, you will see the wolf. The same is true of every dog that has set foot on this earth since dogs began, generations of hounds and herding dogs, lap dogs and sled dogs. Despite the best efforts of our species to change their species, dogs are still, at heart, the animals they came from. Pack animals with a language that's in many ways close to our own, making them a good fit in our own families. That means Maltese or Malamute, toy poodle or Tibetan Mastiff, every dog is going to understand the meaning of a smile, both human and canine. Every dog is going to enjoy a good sniff of, and probably a roll on, the most disgusting, smelly thing available. And every dog, no matter the mix or breed, wants to be part of a family, a pack. Considering canine packaging. Every dog may be a wolf at heart, but we've certainly done plenty to change the rest of the package, to soften some traits and strengthen others. No species on Earth shows such diversity of size, shape, and purpose. In my own home, I have dogs who'd crawl on their bellies for miles, skip meals, and forgo sleep on the off chance that someone, somewhere, will throw something into a body of water for them to retrieve again and again and again until they fall over from exhaustion, still dripping the water that is as much their element as the air they breathe. One of my other dogs walks around puddles but has a tendency to herd children. My dogs are retrieving and herding dogs, in case you didn't guess. The behavior of one comes from the instinct to fetch prey. The other is motivated by an age-old desire to drive prey. Along the way, these hunting behaviors were separated, one to the retriever, one to the sheepdog, and bred to be stronger to give the animals a function in the human community. Tip: dog breeds and breed types differ in size, activity level, shedding level, and trainability. That means that becoming a canine expert is a good idea. Not for the opportunity to impress the family when you see a dog show on TV. The Schipperke, a Belgian breed, first became popular as a watchdog for use on canal boats, you can say with authority. But for the ability to analyze how any particular breed or breed type will work as a member of your family. Remember, choosing the right dog for you, your family, and your lives is the first step in acquiring the dog of your dreams. Go back in time again to the wolf. Remember many of those desirable breed traits, chasing game, herding sheep, and protecting the pack, are wolf traits that have been strengthened or adjusted over time to make dogs a better fit in the human community. Other vestiges of other wolf traits live on in today's dogs, including the desire to know exactly where one stands in the pack, whether it's a canine or human family, and the accompanying desire to better one's status. See how like us they are? Dogs in general are a little more easygoing than wolves, thanks to thousands of years of domestication. But you have to look no farther than dog bite statistics to see that some problems still exist in the relationship between their kind and ours. Warning. The normal victims of these power struggles are children, the smallest, most vulnerable members of the pack. When I read stories of a family dog, commonly an unneutered male from one of the currently popular tough breeds, that has attacked a child without warning, I know that's not the whole story. While you may find some psycho dogs, in most cases the humans had more to do with the outcome than the dog did. They got a breed that was too much for them, compounded the problem by not socializing and training the animal, and then didn't recognize the warning signs of a dog looking to be leader. The result was a tragedy for both the child, who must live with the repercussions of an attack for the rest of his life, and for the dog, who usually loses his life in the aftermath. Need a better reason to proceed with caution in choosing a dog? I didn't think so. Statistics show the dogs involved in attacks are most commonly unneutered males, especially young adults coming into their prime. Just another reason why neutering is so important. For more reasons to neuter your pet, see Chapter 17. Warning. Call of the Wild. Wolf-dog hybrids. We never seem to get the balance right when it comes to wolves. First, we hated them, almost to extinction. Now we love them, and their close relatives, wolf-dog hybrids, with a devotion that is for many wolf-dogs as lethal as the hatred it replaced. The result of a breeding between a wolf and a dog, most commonly a husky, malamute, or German shepherd, the wolf-dog hybrid is a beautiful, intelligent animal and a potentially dangerous companion that few people can handle or adequately care for. They are often destructive and can rarely be house-trained. Determined and resourceful escape artists, they can be chillingly efficient predators. On these points, virtually everyone agrees. On the point of whether they should be allowed a place in human society at all, widespread and often heated disagreement exists. The intelligence that fanciers adore, combined with size and strength, causes problems at maturity when wolf hybrids do what comes naturally, try for a higher place in their social order, challenging the authority of their human packmates. Human deaths and injuries are more common with these animals as compared to domesticated dogs as a whole, and you hear many anecdotal accounts of vicious attacks, especially on children, by seemingly docile wolf-dog pets. It's not their fault. It's their nature. Because of these problems, some communities have tried to ban the wolf-dog hybrids. Many humane and animal control shelters will not put them up for adoption, and the few groups that do give permanent sanctuary to unwanted hybrids are always at capacity. As a result, many a wolf-dog hybrid has paid for the surge in popularity with its life. All of which means the wolf-dog hybrid is a pet all but a few highly experienced and dedicated dog lovers should avoid. Always look at the history of your particular breed. A large, powerful dog developed to protect land or property, working on his own and making his own judgments, is not likely to accept your input graciously. He may be highly intelligent and even biddable in the hands of experienced dog handlers, but in many situations, he's all too often a time bomb. Remember, for most people and most families, the best dog is one from a breed, or a mix of breeds, that has been developed to be responsive to training and human guidance and isn't too hung up on being in charge. Dogs specially developed as companions, such as the toy breeds, fill that role, and so do some hunting and herding breeds, such as the Golden Retriever or the Collie. Letting go of love at first sight. In dogs, as in humans, the one you're immediately and most powerfully attracted to may not be the best bet for a long-term companion. You may have grown up with collies in a suburban home with a large yard and your mother home all day, and you may still consider the collie your favorite breed. But a collie may not be the best choice for you today if you live alone in an apartment and are fond of expensive clothes in dark colors. So start fresh with a fair appraisal of your life and of the dogs who offer the best fit. I grew up in a home where the undisputed best breed of all time was considered to be a boxer. While I'm still fond of them, one of my nephews is my brother's boxer, Taz. I haven't lived with one since I left home. The reason? Dog saliva gives me hives, and while boxers aren't the drooliest breed around, the Newfoundland would probably win that prize, they are drooly enough to make me limit my exposure to them. My mother, on the other hand, thinks nothing of carrying a towel to wipe off a dog, but the little fur mice that congregate in the corners of my house, my dogs shed so much I'm thinking of having sweaters made from the fur, would make her scream. I keep the handheld vacuum close by, but otherwise pay little attention to the fact that my medium-coated dogs drop black fur, hair by hair, every day, and the long-haired one produces enough gray, white, and tan fuzz during his twice-yearly big shed to fill a grocery bag a week. Fur or drool? Sometimes choosing a dog that suits you comes down to something as simple as that. Starting from scratch. Choosing a breed or breed type is one of the most enjoyable aspects of adopting a dog. You have a chance to window shop on a grand scale, to discover dogs you've never heard of and imagine life with breeds you've never seen before. Start with an open mind and be honest about your own life, your own preferences, your own expectations. Keep these factors in mind: size and space requirements, activity level, fur factor, and trainability and dominance. Sizing up a breed type. The range of size in dogs is truly remarkable, so broad that even though they are the same species, it would be unthinkable for a dog from one end of the spectrum, say a St. Bernard, to mate with one from the other, like a toy poodle. Although never underestimate the desire of any dog to try to make such a coupling possible. Some people who adore small dogs are scared of large ones. Some who adore large ones speak derisively of small ones, considering them less than real dogs and calling them powder puffs, dust mops, or rats. Size doesn't seem to matter as much to the dogs themselves as to the people who own them. Many small dogs have the pugnacious attitude that would be downright dangerous in a large dog, and many large dogs want nothing more than to curl up in their owner's laps. Remember, for the sake of practicality, size is the first factor you should look at when choosing a dog, if for no other reason than figuring out the cost difference between keeping a dog that eats 1/4 cup of food a day versus one that eats 7 cups. My, that's a big dog. For some people, only a large dog will do. Large dogs are the perfect choice for active people, joggers, hikers, and cross-country skiers. Even the friendliest large dog is a bigger crime deterrent than the surliest small dog, although crime prevention experts say that even small dogs do a good job of alerting owners to the presence of strangers and letting the bad guys know that their approach has not gone unnoticed. Should you consider protection training for your dog? See Chapter 14. Large dogs can pull a wagon, walk for miles, chase a ball for hours. They are usually not so sensitive to the ear pulls and tail grabs of children, and a solid pat on the ribs will not send them flying across the room. Although a small dog may seem like a hot water bottle if you let him share your bed, a large one may seem like a hot water heater, as reassuring a presence and as loud, if they snore, as another human. Still, there are trade-offs. The bigger a dog gets, the more food she eats and the more waste she produces. Big dogs can be more difficult to handle, more likely to knock over your toddler or your grandmother, more capable of destroying your home, more likely to inflict a serious injury should they decide to bite. A pushy small dog is amusing. A pushy large one is dangerous. Large dogs are harder to travel with and more expensive to kennel. If you don't own your own home, you may find securing housing that accepts a large dog nearly impossible. Larger breeds generally need more exercise and are more likely to find other ways to shed nervous energy, like digging, barking, or chewing, if they don't get enough to keep them happy. Even the largest dogs are not impossible to keep in apartments, townhouses, and homes with small yards. If you doubt it, visit any doggy playgroup in Manhattan. But you have to work doubly hard to meet their exercise needs under those circumstances. Another thing to consider if you are an urban dog owner is that a small dog can use a couple sheets of newspaper for relief on those blizzard days, while with a large dog, the Sunday New York Times won't suffice. Little things mean a lot. They may get their share of snickers, but little dogs don't care. They live a life big dogs can only dream about. Only a small dog can sneak into a department store hidden in an oversized purse. This kind of portability, the go-anywhere functionality, combined with adorable faces and shoe-button eyes, makes the small dog a whole lot more fun to own than a lot of real dog people can imagine. Some practical advantages exist, too. You can give a small dog a bath in the kitchen sink without straining your back lifting the animal. A small dog can sit in your lap while you watch TV. They're no trouble to walk, even for small children. Food costs are low. Your walk is a rapid trot for them, so exercise is easy. Remember, on the negative side, toy breeds can be yappy and they are definitely fragile, which makes them unsuitable for homes with boisterous children. They have to be protected, too, from large dogs, some of which may consider a powder puff dog as an appetizer. Keeping up with your dog. Activity level isn't tied to size, except at the extremes. Some of the largest dogs seem barely interested in getting out of bed in the morning, while some of the smallest are on the go practically 24 hours a day. In between are dogs of all sizes and various activity levels. Tip: you can sometimes gauge a breed's activity level by looking at the work it was bred to perform, but still, all you're getting is an overall impression. Each individual varies by breeding, age, and health, although the general rule holds true. If a dog was bred to go all day long, a sporting breed, for example, it is going to be more consistently up than a large, heavy guarding breed that only worked when intruders arrived. Dogs such as Dalmatians, bred to run for miles alongside carriages or horse-drawn fire trucks, aren't likely to take a laid-back attitude toward life. Terriers, developed to keep vermin at bay, are always on the alert and ready to rumble. Puppy testing can also give you an idea about activity levels and is especially useful when evaluating a pup whose parents are of different breeds. See Chapter 4 for more information. Some breed types tend to be selectively active, on outside, off indoors. Many hunting dogs and their mixes are active in the fresh air and fields, but are fairly content to curl up in front of the fire in the house after their exercise requirements have been met. The world's fastest dog, the racing greyhound, is so fond of lounging that one rescue group calls the animal a 40-mile-per-hour couch potato. Tip: you can take the edge off the problems high activity can trigger, destructiveness and barking, for example, by giving active dogs enough aerobic exercise daily to keep them happy. When my retrievers don't get their exercise, they drive me crazy while I work. One good run or a fast-paced game of fetch settles them down just fine. Activity level means more than exercise requirements, of course. Some breeds like not only to be moving constantly, but also to be keeping the world informed of their activities. Hyperactivity and yappiness are also a matter of individual preference. One person's watchdog is another's yappy pest. For others, the playful liveliness of such breeds is ample trade-off for a little, or a lot, of extra barking. Again, be aware of what your tolerances are. Training can take the edge off the most undesirable of temperament traits, but nothing in this world can turn a peppy, barky Sheltie into a calm, quiet bulldog. Warning. Some active breeds are so yappy that even their fanciers can't stand the noise and routinely have their dogs debarked. While the surgical removal of the vocal cords is sometimes the last chance for an otherwise good dog's survival, a discussion of barking problems is in Chapter 15, a breeder whose own dogs are debarked ought to give you pause. At the very least, debarked parents suggest that your puppy may grow into a dog who is unlikely to let a leaf fall without barking at it. Facing up to fur. Let me settle one thing up front. There's no such thing as a dog with fur that doesn't shed. The slight hedge is for such breeds as the hairless variety of the Chinese crested, a tiny little dog that can't shed what it doesn't have. The corollary is that there's no such thing as a dog that's hypoallergenic. Some dogs do shed less and may be manageable for some asthmatics and allergy sufferers, but if you're not prepared for or capable of handling fur, you're better off with goldfish, not a cat and not a bird, because those can be even worse for many allergy sufferers. The long and short of it. All dogs are covered with fur, except for the aforementioned Chinese crested and a couple of other rare hairless breeds. But there the similarity ends, for the variety of coat lengths, colors, patterns, and textures is nearly endless. Length? Think short fur like the boxer to start with, then a little longer like a golden retriever, then longer still like a collie, to the long as they can grow preferred locks of the show Commodore, a Rottweiler-sized dog covered with floor-length cords of twisted fur that looks like a cotton mop set in motion. Color? Think sparkling white like some Samoyeds, to glossy black like the Schipperke. Then think of everything in between, all kinds of colors with more words describing them than the marketing division of a fashion house could think up in a year. How about mouse gray, fawn, wild boar, badger, and red stag, wheaten and dead grass, mahogany and chestnut, medium brown, too dull, call the color Isabella. Doberman fanciers do. Patterns? Spots like the Dalmatian, black with tan accents like the Doberman, Rottweiler, Gordon Setter, or Manchester Terrier. Patches like some Great Danes and Akitas. The tiger stripes of the brindles, like boxers or pit bull terriers. The mottled mishmash of color known as merle in some Australian shepherds, collies, and shelties. And don't forget the importance of accessories. White paws, white chest ruffs, and white head blazes. And what about texture? Velvety short, long and silky, or wiry. And that's just in dachshunds. Those coats exist elsewhere in the dog world, too, along with curly coats, wavy coats, rough coats, and smooth coats. Can you say lint brush? The short white hairs of a Dalmatian or the pale ones of a yellow lab turn up on everything and are notoriously hard to get off. The case hunt and the collie, with luxurious coats so long and thick you can lose things in them, shed in the spring and the fall in clumps the size of hamsters, as do most of the breeds with a long, thick overcoat and a downy undercoat. The rest of the year, these fur factories shed normally, as in a lot. Some breeds shed so much long, silky fur that a small industry has sprung up to spin the hair into material for knitting, so dog-loving crafters can fashion their pets' fur into garments. A season's shedding is all they need to get enough yarn for a nice, toasty sweater. More information on shedding is in the grooming section in Chapter 10. Remember, you can handle some of the fur preemptively by frequently combing and brushing your pet. What you pull out on a comb doesn't end up on your sofa, but you're still going to have plenty of hair with many breeds. If the hair is going to drive you crazy, think short-haired dog in darker color so the fur won't show as much. Shedding isn't the only issue. Some dogs, such as poodles, have coats that need clipping every 6 weeks or so. You can learn to do the grooming yourself. Your dog will probably survive the embarrassment. Or you can take him to a groomer. If you choose the latter, that means money. Factor this in when deciding what type of dog to get. Tip: some pet supply catalogs sell lint rollers in bulk at greatly reduced prices, as do pet supply stores. You can also find a rubber, squeegee-like tool that does a great job of pulling fur from carpets and upholstery, and vacuum cleaner attachments specially designed for dealing with pet hair. When I bought my first long-haired dog more than 20 years ago, I left the breeder's home with pages of instructions: what to feed, what shots he'd had, how to get him registered, the names of trainers, the names of veterinarians, and the names of kennels. My head was spinning, and I paused on the porch, a puppy in my arms, and asked the breeder if I needed to know anything else. She thought about it. "Yes," she said. "Never wear black. Fashion dictates otherwise, so I became adept at using lint brushes. Years after Lance grew old and died, I was going through some financial records, looking for a receipt. In the file folder was a tiny tuft of dog hair. His. I almost cried. I have a high tolerance for dog hair, but at least some of my dogs are now in sync with the trend. Jet black. What they throw doesn't show, although the hair is still there. Factoring in intelligence. People are always asking about how smart a particular dog is, as if that's good for anything more than bragging rights. Intelligence is fairly irrelevant when predicting how well a dog is going to work as a member of your family. What's more important is trainability or biddability, qualities that describe how much, or how little, a dog concerns herself with what you want her to do. Technical stuff. Part of the puzzle again goes back to looking at the job a breed was developed to perform. Some dogs, such as hounds, were developed to work alone or with other dogs, but in any case independently of human control. The scent hounds, beagles, bloodhounds, and basset hounds, are more likely to follow their nose than your directions. Sight hounds, Afghan hounds, greyhounds, and salukis aren't going to hear you at all once they get up to chasing speed. That doesn't mean that they won't wag their tail in rapt devotion after you get them back on a leash, but it does mean that in the heat of the chase, their instincts take over. Just as with a tendency to bark, training can take the edge off the tendency to ignore your wishes, but getting your dog to mind is going to be easier with some breeds than with others. Consider three of the breeds most often touted as highly intelligent: the Border Collie, Golden Retriever, and the Doberman Pinscher. These dogs do extremely well in obedience competitions. Does that mean they're smart? Undoubtedly. According to dog intelligence expert Stanley Corin, these three breeds start to understand a command after they've had the command demonstrated less than 5 times. But something else is at work here, and if you think about how and why these dogs were developed, you can see what these breeds, a herding dog, a hunting dog, and a protection dog, have in common. They were all developed to work closely with a human handler. The successful performance of their work function, moving sheep around, retrieving downed game, and patrolling with a police officer or soldier, relied on teamwork between human and animal. They come pre-wired to look to a human for guidance, and if the human knows enough to provide that guidance, these breeds will gladly serve. That's their job, after all. As with activity levels, intelligence and biddability are a little hard to predict in mixed-breed puppies. Puppy testing can help. See Chapter 4 for more information. Decisions, more decisions. You've probably got a breed or two in mind, or an idea of the characteristics you want in a dog. Large, small, long-haired, or short-haired. Before you start looking for your pet, though, you should give a little bit of thought to some other details. What age of dog is right for you? What gender? And how much money is this going to cost anyway? Warning. As with the people who want a Labrador retriever because we've always had labs in our family, those who automatically choose a puppy or always choose a male or female and aren't willing to be flexible on costs may be denying themselves the chance for a good dog. Keep an open mind to the possibility that some details in the mental image of your dream dog should be left vague until you consider absolutely everything. Puppy or grown dog? The advantages of a puppy are obvious. Puppies are adorable, sweet, and cuddly. To look at them is to smile. A puppy is yours to work with, an almost clean slate you can mold to fit perfectly into your life, or completely ruin if you're not careful. Yours will be the only family she knows, as long as you keep up your part of the deal. That said, there are some real advantages to choosing a grown dog. They're often less expensive to acquire and certainly less expensive to maintain, since their puppy shots and wormings are behind them. If you choose carefully, you can find one who's already house-trained and maybe knows a little basic obedience, too. So why don't more people consider a grown dog? The number one reason I hear is that most people believe that a recycled rover doesn't bond as well with their family as a puppy does. That's true if you intend to keep your dog in a barren backyard with little human contact. But if you welcome your dog fully into your life, she's yours just as much as the puppy you took from her mother at 7 weeks. Some people say the bond is tighter because the dog has seen the world and knows how lucky she is. I'm not sure about that, but I've seen plenty of both kinds of dogs and have some of each now. The quality of love they show for their owners and vice versa is the same. Remember, a puppy is a good choice for you if you have the time, patience, and flexibility, not to mention the sense of humor, to deal with canine babyhood and adolescence. You won't find any shortcuts to the delightful business of puppy raising. It's 3 a.m. walks and chewed loafers, endless hours of play, and just as many hours of training. You don't really know what you're going to end up with until you end up with it. This is especially true of mixed-breed puppies, many of whom are bigger or smaller adults than anyone at the shelter could have guessed. Puppyhood is a wonderful trip, full of surprises and delights, but one you shouldn't take if you aren't committed. If you don't put in the effort, you may end up with a dog who drives you crazy, or one you'll drive to the shelter when you can't stand him anymore. Grown dogs have a bad reputation, one that's often undeserved. Aren't grown dogs that are up for adoption usually pets that other people couldn't stand? Is adopting one really such a good idea? It depends on the dog, of course. The real plus is this. While an adjustment period is inevitable with any canine relationship, it's a lot shorter with a grown dog. Can you teach an old dog new tricks? She can be trained. All dogs, young and old, benefit from training. But you won't be able to influence her personality as much. If you've got a puppy with shy or aggressive tendencies, you can do things to help her before a problem arises. More on this in Chapter 9. If you have a shy or aggressive grown dog, change is a lot more difficult and maybe not possible at all. Which is why you shouldn't be influenced by a sad story and big brown eyes when you're considering a grown dog. Remember, a grown dog is an excellent choice for situations where no one is at home during the day. For retirees who love the companionship of a dog but haven't the energy for a puppy. For someone who wants to feel good about giving a decent dog a second chance. There are so many mature dogs who deserve the second chance. Mixed breeds and purebreds both. Retired racing dogs, service dogs, and show dogs. Dogs whose owners have died, divorced, or moved. Dogs who want nothing more than the chance to belong to someone. In all the time I've been writing about dogs, I've watched lots of puppies grow up and disappear because the people who bought them did so because of emotion, not common sense. Consider your situation carefully, and if you honestly aren't up for a year of puppy antics, adopt a grown dog instead. Male or female? Does a male or female dog make a better pet? There's no way of settling that question for sure, so for most people, the choice comes down to personal preference. You should consider some differences, however, because even spaying and neutering doesn't make males and females the same. If you do not plan to spay or neuter your pet, more about that in Chapter 17, the differences are more distinct. Unspayed females are generally moodier than unneutered males. Although males tend to be more constant in temperament, they can be annoying in their constant pursuit of such male dog activities as sex, leg lifting, and territory protection. Some would say constancy isn't a positive trait in these cases, and argue that some unneutered males aren't just constant, but rather constantly annoying. Unspayed females usually come into season for a couple weeks twice a year, during which time you need to deal with a varying amount of mess and the constant attention of canine suitors. Unneutered males may be less than attentive to your commands when the luscious smell of females and heat beckons. They can also be more likely to challenge your leadership, or anyone else's, at any time. Studies have shown, for example, that young, unneutered males are the most likely to be involved in attacks on children. Spaying or neutering generally evens things out a bit. It makes females more emotionally constant and males less likely to fight or roam. But differences remain. Technical stuff. In some breeds, for example, males are considerably larger than females, as much as 20 or 30 pounds and 2 or 3 inches. The Complete Dog Book, available in most libraries and bookstores, contains the official AKC breed standards, the blueprint of each breed in all areas, including size. This should give you an idea of the size difference to expect, as in this citation regarding the Newfoundland. Average height for adult dogs, males, is 28 inches. For adult bitches, 26 inches. Approximate weight of adult dogs ranges from 130 to 150 pounds, adult bitches from 100 to 120 pounds. Other differences aren't so easily defined. In the more dominant breeds, such as the Rottweiler, a female may be sweeter and more anxious to please. In the more shy and standoffish breeds, such as the Shetland Sheepdog, a male may be more outgoing and friendly. In some breeds, such as the Golden Retriever, you might not notice much difference at all, especially in altered pets. Tip: it's a better idea to concentrate on the breed or breed type rather than the gender, since the toughest male of an easygoing breed is probably a bigger cupcake than the mildest female of a breed with dominant tendencies. Talking to reputable breeders gives you a clear picture how the sexes differ, not only in the breed as a whole, but also in particular breeding lines. For some people, the choice comes down to a matter of landscaping. Males kill shrubs by lifting their legs on them. Females kill lawns by squatting. Although some males squat and some females lift, at least some of the time, the generalization is pretty much on the mark. For more on dogs and landscaping, see Chapter 22. Cost considerations. How much should a puppy or dog cost? Prices vary so widely that you can pay anything from free to the, generally, less than $50 that shelters charge, to the deal of the century price that breed rescue groups charge for purebreds, to several hundred for an ordinary purebred, to several thousand dollars for a show-quality dog of a rare or red-hot breed. In general, however, a purebred, pet-quality puppy from a reputable breeder costs between $400 and $1,000, depending on several factors. Breeds that have small litters, such as many of the toy dogs, may cost more because there are fewer puppies to cover the costs of screening the dam for congenital defects, transporting her to the stud dog, paying the stud fee, caring for the mother during her pregnancy, and caring for the mother and puppies in the weeks that follow. Breeds such as the bulldog require high levels of veterinary care in the breeding process, including cesarean sections, and that too boosts the price of puppies. Puppies with the potential to be successful in such canine endeavors as dog shows, field trials, or protection competition are more expensive because these features are add-ons in the same way that a bigger engine or better options package drive up the price of a new car. Bear in mind that a reputable breeder produces dogs hoping to improve her lines and, by extension, her breed, but she raises all her pups to be healthy companions first. More puppies end up with people who want a pet than with people who want a show dog, and a good breeder wants them all to be happy and well cared for. If you want to lower your cost, consider this. Those things that distinguish the pick puppies, which can be something as unidentifiable to the majority of people as the correct placement of dots on a Dalmatian, are not really very significant to those who are looking for a companion animal. A knowledgeable breeder can explain those differences, most of which you can pick up by studying the breed standard. Remember, the true cost of a dog, of course, is in the upkeep, but at least you get to make payments on that. The most cost-conscious proper care, food, basic gear, preventive veterinary care, boarding or pet sitting while you're on vacation, will cost you hundreds of dollars a year and into the thousands for a 100-pound-plus dog who can consume 6 or 7 cups of high-quality kibble a day. Add in occasional veterinary emergencies and the strictly optional but enjoyable collecting of such tempting canine merchandise as a wardrobe of fancy collars, a softer, more decor-conscious bed, pictures with Santa, and breed wind chimes, and the cost of keeping a dog can consume a significant percentage of your budget. As a result, you should keep the cost of acquiring a dog in perspective. A $500 purebred puppy from a reputable breeder costs $50 a year if you figure the cost over a 10-year lifespan, and $50 is about what it costs to keep my dogs in kibble for a month. In the end, it's what you feel comfortable with, purebred or mixed, shelter dog or show dog. The price you pay has no bearing on the love a dog can offer. Chapter 2. Narrowing the field. In this chapter, choosing a mixed breed, evaluating purebreds, understanding the most popular breeds. If I ask you to choose a subject you feel certain everyone has an opinion on, what would you pick? Politics? Religion? Sports? I've never met a person who couldn't answer this question. What's your favorite, or least favorite, breed of dog? Even people who'd never own a dog, wouldn't think of petting one, and cross the street when one approaches, are interested enough in dogs to know, or be misinformed about, the breed they'd least like to see off-leash. As for dog lovers, the topic of breed favorites can keep conversation going, civilly, one hopes, for hours. Even people who prefer all Americans, the politically correct term for mutt, show a definite affinity for breed type. Curly-headed little poodle mixes, strapping lab crosses, or scrappy terrier crosses. Technical stuff. What exactly is a breed? Do papers make the dog? Does popularity? Some crosses, such as the cockapoo, one parent a cocker, the other a poodle, are so common that people start to think of them as a breed in their own right. And while the major purebred registries aren't in the business of recognizing such dogs, groups are springing up all the time to acknowledge their popularity. Simply put, a purebred dog is one that, when bred with another of its kind, produces more of the same. Breed a poodle to a poodle and you get a litter of smart, curly-coated wonders. Breed a cocker to a cocker and you get long-eared, sweet-natured pups with eyes you can get lost in. Breed a cockapoo to a cockapoo, though, and you won't necessarily get more of the same. Some pups may look like the parents, some like poodles, and some like cockers. The ability to produce predictable traits when bred is what defines a purebred, which makes the cocker spaniel a breed, and so too the poodle, but not cockapoos, or terrapoos, peekapoos, or labradoodles. Lots of mixes are out there, great pets one and all. but a breed? Sorry, no. Playing favorites. I became convinced of breed loyalty years ago when I realized that the dog show is the only sporting event where 90% of the spectators couldn't care less about the winner. People come for a variety of reasons, the following being only a few. For the pure and simple pleasure of looking at the dogs, to talk about the dogs, to look at breed-related merchandise, keychains, books, and I Love My Doberman bumper stickers, to celebrate their last dog acquisition, that Akita looks just like Kiro, or their next, to debate the relative merits of the three kinds of setters, English, Irish, and Gordon, to argue if taller, like the Irish wolfhound, or heavier, like the Newfoundland, is the criterion for biggest, and which one eats more. To marvel at the contrasts between long-legged and short-legged, between slender and stocky, between big and little. To celebrate the dog in all its many incredible variations. But mark my words, no matter how many breeds they study, how many they talk about, how many they touch, the people leaving a dog show take with them the sure knowledge that their favorite breed, or favorite breed type, is best. Everyone believes that everyone else is slightly daft or sorely misguided not to share this point of view. The difference of opinion makes for good-natured discussions, that's for sure. Although I lean toward hunting and herding dogs, some of my best friends are seriously into hound breeds, lovely, long-legged darlings such as the Scottish Deerhound and the Greyhound. They roll their eyes when my retrievers run for a chance to swim, since their dogs don't even like walking through puddles. And my dog's constant zest for life sometimes leaves them cold. Retrievers, they sniff. Don't they ever settle down? I give as good as I get, of course, and we all know we're only teasing. We may have different dogs, but we're all dog lovers. Reputable breeders strive to produce dogs that closely conform to a document called the Breed Standard, a blueprint that lays out the rules for things as major as size and as relatively minor as the distribution of dots on a Dalmatian. The breed clubs decide the rules, and organizations such as the American Kennel Club serve as the keeper of the standard. Dog show judges follow these standards to make their choices. American breed standards, along with official breed histories, are collected in the Complete Dog Book, Howell Bookhouse, the American Kennel Club's Bible. Other registries will share their breed standards if you write to them. To find out more about what those judges are actually looking for and how a dog becomes a champion, see Chapter 16. Mixed breeds. Mixed breeds, mongrels, or mutts. Call them anything you want, but millions of them are out there, each and every one of them a true original. Some people tell you that getting a mixed breed is a huge gamble. You don't know how big your puppy will get or what she will look like when she's grown. You don't know if her father is a purebred dog with bad hips and a roving eye. You don't know if the circumstances of her birth and lack of early socialization by owners who wanted neither her nor her littermates and could not dump them fast enough will have long-term consequences that make her unsuitable as a family pet. All of these statements are true, but let me clue you in. It's all a gamble, even with purebred dogs. You do the most you can to better the odds in your favor, close your eyes, say a prayer, and throw the dice. And you can do things to improve your odds with mixed-breed dogs. Work with shelters and rescue groups that test the temperament and check out the health of the animals they put up for adoption. The best ones take the concept of adoptability a step further, putting dogs with problems through training and working with new owners after placement to smooth over the rough spots. You can find more on dealing with shelters and rescue groups in Chapter 3. Remember, what you should not do is encourage irresponsibility by taking a mixed-breed puppy from the kids outside the supermarket or the woman selling them for $5 at the flea market. Why? Do you really think people who just want to dump puppies have taken care of the mother during pregnancy? Do you think they've given the puppies proper food and medical care, shots and worming on schedule, Do you think someone who produces mixed-breed puppies intentionally, cockapoos, peekapoos, or supersized pit bull mixes, is concerned with how many unwanted dogs die every year? What does that leave you with? I'll tell you. People who shouldn't be breeding dogs. People who are contributing to the millions of dogs put to sleep as surplus or unwanted every year. People who haven't educated themselves enough to care or have chosen to ignore the consequences of their actions. Don't encourage this behavior. Do consider a mixed-breed dog and look for one in a shelter or from a rescue group. You can do more things with mixed-breed dogs than ever before. You can get them certified as a canine good citizen. See Chapter 18 for more on this program. You can train them and take them to the highest levels of national obedience competitions. You can train for the sport of agility. More on these in Chapter 16. And you can love the heck out of them and be loved in return, which is, after all, the highest calling any dog can follow. Who knows? You may even save on veterinary bills. While the evidence is far from conclusive, some experts assert that mixed breeds are healthier than purebreds. Don't count on it, though. Many mixed-breed dogs don't draw from a gene pool any larger than most purebreds. They're often crossbreds rather than true mixes, the offspring of two purebred dogs of different breeds. And as such, they've got a lot of the same inherited health problems purebreds do. Evaluating breeds. The rest of this chapter is a broad overview of the more than 150 breeds available in the United States and Canada today. And after I go over all the possibilities, I include a section on the purebreds most people will choose, the popular ones. Dog breeds are divided by their original purpose into groups, including these AKC classifications: sporting, hounds, working, terriers, toys, non-sporting, herding. Technical stuff. Why go with the American Kennel Club groupings? Because the venerable AKC is the Microsoft of the dog world, omnipresent and dominant, with an impact on all things dog. Only the Kennel Club in Great Britain can touch the AKC's clout. Other registries are out there, to be sure, including the Canadian Kennel Club, and in the United States, the United Kennel Club and the American Rare Breed Association. But no canine organization, and there are thousands all over the world, is better known than the American Kennel Club, for better or for worse. I've used AKC rankings and groupings for examples in this chapter, but the popularity and availability of a breed in any particular country varies. Remember, no dog is perfect. Remember, every breed is perfect for someone, but no breed is suitable for everyone. Some breeds or breed types, because of reasonable size and activity levels, low maintenance coats, high trainability, and low dominance, fit in a majority of dog-loving homes. Many of these breeds are not as well known as others, and I've singled these and some others out for special consideration if you're looking to add a furry bundle to your home. Still, no matter what any expert says, you're the one who has to live with your choice. So do your homework, be realistic, and proceed with caution. I provide the background of the dogs in each of these groupings so that you can get a sense of what the breed was developed to do, which is an important step in determining how it will fit into your life. Note: when I mention breeds that are good or bad, the terms are not used to denigrate the breed itself, but rather to evaluate its suitability as a pet in an average family with neither the background nor the time to work with a less suitable breed. Warning: with purebreds, breeding counts. If it were possible to have the sidebar title printed in red with a red box and red arrows pointing to it, I would. That's because every day, yes, every day, I hear from a reader who has adopted a ton of heartache in getting the right breed from the wrong source. Health and temperament problems are rampant in purebred dogs, and your chances of getting a dog with a problem increase dramatically when you buy from a less than reputable source, such as a casual backyard breeder. This is especially true of popular breeds such as Labradors, Goldens, and Rotties. Most purebred dogs in the United States are registered with the AKC, which also awards titles for show championships and other dog sports. Although the organization has assumed investigative and educational responsibilities over the years, the AKC is primarily in the business of processing paperwork. AKC is not a brand name like Sony or Chevrolet. The organization, which is actually a federation of breed and kennel clubs, neither breeds dogs nor certifies breeders. All the time you spend reading about breeds, considering breeds, and finally choosing a breed is completely and totally wasted if you rush out and buy from someone who isn't raising good examples of the breed. Your chances of getting a Labrador or Chow Chow or French Bulldog with the qualities associated with the breed rely on your ability to find a reputable breeder. Chapter 3 offers information on choosing a breeder. Warning: genetic defects are common in purebred dogs thanks to unscrupulous, ignorant, or careless breeders. In addition to being a poor choice for a family pet, a sick dog can cost you lots of money. Among the most common inherited defects is hip dysplasia, a malformation of the hip joint. While hip dysplasia is widespread in medium and large-sized dogs, other common congenital defects are more breed-specific, such as deafness in Dalmatians. You must become aware of which defects are common in whatever breed you choose so that you know to find a puppy whose parents have been checked out by a registry such as the Orthopedic Foundation for Animals or the Canine Eye Registry Foundation. The Sporting Group. Some of the best dogs for families are in this group, so you shouldn't be surprised that some of the most popular breeds, including the first and second most popular breeds, the Labrador and Golden Retrievers, call the sporting group home. One other sporting dog, the Cocker Spaniel, also routinely claims a spot in the AKC's top 10. Like the hounds, these are hunting dogs. Unlike the hounds, sporting dogs cannot trace an ancestry to the earliest stages of human-dog companionship. Their development is more recent and is tied to the invention of the device that changed the world in so many other respects, the gun. Sporting dogs, setters, pointers, retrievers, and spaniels, were developed not to chase and to kill game, but to help firearm-equipped hunters locate game birds, flush the birds from hiding places so that they could be shot, and bring back the dead and injured to the hunter's hand without further damage. While the traditional work of many breeds, such as the bulldog, bred to fight a bull for the bloody amusement of the masses, is thankfully no longer available, many sporting dogs still practice their craft. Thousands are dual-purpose animals. Family pets who roll around with children by day and sleep on the beds by night, they are also working dogs who spend fall weekends joyously slogging through half-frozen fields with the hunter of the family. Nor is their work confined to hunting. Within this group are two breeds, Golden and Labrador Retrievers, commonly trained to serve as helpers for people who are blind or use wheelchairs. In addition, the keen noses of many sporting dogs have been put to good use detecting drugs or explosives. Most of these dogs are large, but not overly so, for a massive breed would possess neither the agility nor the stamina to survive a day in the field. Some smaller breeds are in this group too, most notably the Cocker Spaniel, a happy little dog that doesn't do much hunting, but has taken a couple of turns at the top of the popularity charts. Coats are pretty reasonable in this group, as befits any class of dogs bred to spend time amongst the brambles. Short, medium, and wiry coats are the rule. The exception is the Cocker Spaniel and to some extent the Golden Retriever, breeds that rarely hunt anymore and have more coat than would make sense for a field dog to bear. Warning: popularity often breeds disaster, and that's certainly true of some breeds in this group. The Cocker Spaniel, in fact, could be the poster dog for the problems of popularity. What could be a near-perfect family dog should be sold with a warning label today because of health and temperament problems caused by bad breeders. Some Cockers are so unstable they cannot be trusted around children. others are made miserable by no fewer than a half dozen common congenital problems. You have to be very careful when dealing with this breed and find a reputable breeder. The same is true of others in this group, most notably the Labrador and Golden Retrievers. More on finding a reputable source for a dog is in Chapter 3. Technical stuff. In many sporting breeds, some dogs differ enough in body structure and temperament that they could almost be separate breeds. In most of these breeds, the split is between show and field, that is, dogs bred with lots of coat and a more laid-back attitude for the show ring, versus dogs bred for hunting instinct, a more practical amount of coat, and an intensity for work that is a must in field competitions. Unless you intend to hunt with your pet, a dog from a reputable show breeder is probably a better bet because the energy and intensity of a field trial dog can be a poor fit with all but the most active households. Technical stuff. Sporting breeds in brief. History. The first dog registered with the American Kennel Club in 1886 was from the sporting group, the English setter Adonis. The sporting group, which once included hounds, was one of two original groups, the other was non-sporting, and sporting dogs have been important in every imaginable canine endeavor ever since. Most popular, Labrador Retriever, number one in AKC rankings for 1999. Least popular, Sussex Spaniel, number 138 in AKC rankings for 1999. Small to medium-sized breeds, 24 to 50 pounds, American Water Spaniel, Brittany, Cocker Spaniel, English Cocker Spaniel, English Springer Spaniel, Field Spaniel, Sussex Spaniel, Welsh Springer Spaniel. Large breeds, 50 to 80 pounds, Chesapeake Bay Retriever, Clumber Spaniel, Curly-Coated Retriever, English Setter, Flat-Coated Retriever, German Short-Haired Pointer, German Wire-Haired Pointer, Golden Retriever, Gordon Setter, Irish Water Spaniel, Labrador Retriever, Pointer, Spinoni Italiano, Wiesla, Weimaraner, Wire-Haired Pointing Griffin. Activity level. Most sporting breeds have energy to burn, but the heavy, low-slung Clumber and Sussex Spaniels are relatively calm. Some lesser-known breeds worth a good look. American Water Spaniel. A good-natured, easily trained, and adaptable dog, this smaller breed, developed by hunters in Wisconsin, is covered in short curls. Nova Scotia Duck Tolling Retriever. I'm breaking the rules here. The toller is registered by the Canadian Kennel Club, but not the American. Given the speed with which the AKC adds breeds these days, that may change in the years to come. This good-natured dog has a lot in common with Golden Retrievers, but in a smaller package, often with more energy. Wiesla. Think athleticism, brains, and an easy-care short coat in a manageable medium-sized dog, and you'll be picturing this versatile and friendly Hungarian dog. The Hound Group. The Hound Group consists of scent hounds, dogs who hunt by scent, sight hounds, dogs who hunt by sight, and one breed, the Dachshund, that, based on its development to go to ground after vermin, arguably belongs with the terriers. Some of the oldest known of the world's breeds, such as the Saluki and Greyhound, are in this group, as well as breeds that have been in the United States since before the Revolutionary War. George Washington kept foxhounds at Mount Vernon. The records he kept on his dogs date to 1758. The size range is dramatic in this group, from miniature dachshunds, about 5 inches tall at the shoulder with a weight of less than 10 pounds, to the tallest dog of all, the Irish Wolfhound, more than 30 inches tall and weighing more than 100 pounds. For many of these breeds, you need look no further than their names to find the key to their origin. Otterhounds were developed in England to hunt otters. Rabbits were the prey of harriers. For other breeds, this naming trend doesn't hold true. The Pharaoh in Pharaoh Hound is a reference not to the dog's preferred game, but to his antiquity. The Petit Basset Griffon Vendéen was bred to hunt rabbits in France, but you wouldn't know that from the name, which means small, low-slung, wire-coated dog of Vendée, Vendée being a French province. Two of the most recognizable breeds in the world are in this group, the Basset Hound and the Dachshund. So too is one of the world's most unusual breeds, the Basenji, which is incapable of barking and communicates pleasure by chortling or yodeling. Some wonderful potential pets are in this group, most notably the Beagle, a happy, sturdy dog considered to be an outstanding companion for children. Highly recommended, too, is the Basset Hound. Do not expect hound breeds to watch your every step out of doors, however. They've got better things to do, following their nose and their eyes as their heritage demands. Come can be a difficult concept for many hounds. House training can be tough with the scent hounds. Coats are generally low maintenance. Most, but not all, of these breeds are short or wire-haired. The most notable exception is the Afghan hound, whose long, silky coat tangles and mats quickly without constant attention. Tip: greyhounds don't rank that highly in AKC statistics, 129th in the most recent rankings, but that number is deceiving. Uncounted numbers of greyhounds aren't registered with the AKC at all. They're racing dogs, coming straight off the track. With the growth of rescue organizations, these fleet-footed hounds are becoming an increasingly popular pet, as word has gotten out on their generally sweet nature. The Working Group. No doubt about it. Some pretty tough customers are in the working group, made up of no-nonsense dogs who earned their keep as protectors and load pullers. Technical stuff. Hound breeds in brief. History. The most ancient of all known breeds can be found in this group. The first hounds, a Basset Hound, Beagle, Bloodhound, Dachshund, Greyhound, and Harrier, were registered with the AKC in 1885. The hound breeds were originally classified with the sporting breeds, but got their own group in the late 1920s. Most popular? Beagle, number 5 in AKC rankings for 1999. Least popular? Otterhound, number 157 in AKC rankings for 1999. Tiny breeds, less than 20 pounds. Dachshunds, standard and miniature. Small to medium-sized breeds, 20 to 50 pounds, Basenji, Basset Hound, Beagle, Harrier, Norwegian Elk Hound, Petit Basset Griffon Vendéen, Whippet. Large breeds, 50 to 80 pounds, Afghan Hound, American Foxhound, Black and Tan Coonhound, English Foxhound, Greyhound, Ibizan Hound, Faroe Hound, Rhodesian Ridgeback, Saluki. Giant breeds, more than 80 pounds. Bloodhound, Borzoi, Irish Wolfhound, Otterhound, Scottish Deerhound. Activity level. Most hounds have energy to burn, but most breeds are fairly calm in the house. Greyhounds, for example, are often called 40-mile-per-hour couch potatoes for their decided preference for napping. Scent hounds tend to be more active than sight hounds. Some lesser-known breeds worth a good look. Borzoi, a gentle, good-natured giant who's happy to nap the days away. If you're thinking of a manageable dog in a jumbo-sized package, this breed should be one you consider. Petit Basset Griffon Vendéen. Contrary to popular impression, this happy hound is not a wire-haired Basset Hound. The breed is considerably more agile and energetic than the Basset, a good choice for an active family. Plus, that fuzzy face melts your heart. Whippet. The poor man's racehorse, according to the breed standard, the Whippet is a lot tougher than his delicate looks suggest, yet gentle and quiet. He loves to snuggle, and his smooth coat is as close to low maintenance as you could wish for. Some dogs here relied on their size and untrusting attitude to keep the belongings of their employers safe. In recent years, the Rottweiler has been the fad protection breed of choice, their popularity fueled by fear of crime and the desire of some to own a formidable animal, whether they can control him or not. Some of dogdom's gentle giants, the Great Dane and Newfoundland, are in this group, along with versatile smaller breeds developed for other work, but who today excel in obedience and other dog sports. Modernity seems to have eluded.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.